conservative legislature that I know we have because I read it in the paper, that could not give us true tort reform and immigration reform, we got to do better. We got to stop rewarding people for breaking into this country.
Yeah.
I've seen some estimates as high as $300 billion is what it's costing our taxpayers for illegal immigrant government services. If you're in this country, you need to understand that it's a privilege and not a right. We have bought and paid for this with our blood and our sweat and our tears and our lives.
That's right.
And just because you show up does not mean we owe you anything. If you're here, you got to be here legally. If you want to work here, you got to be in the tax system. If you want to live here, you need to be a contributor and not a taker. And if you want to be a citizen, we have a process that many have followed, and you need to follow it. And for me, please learn to speak English.
Thank you.
So we have about 2 minutes left. Let's talk about Bill Nelson. My friends, don't kid yourself. Bill Nelson's going to be formidable. This isn't Kendrick Meek. Now, right now, as Republicans, we're pretty busy congratulating ourselves for this big election last November. But let's take a hard look at statewide race. How many Republicans won a statewide race against a sitting Democrat for that job?
Almost none.
85%.
None. No Republican won a statewide race against a sitting Democrat incumbent for that job. The only person that ran against an incumbent was Rick Scott, and Alex Sink was not the sitting governor. The Democrats now have about 500,000 more registered voters in Florida than Republicans do. They are studying this last election, and they are not going to make the same mistakes. Marco Rubio split the Democrat vote with the sitting governor for Senate, who ran on an independent ticket. That ain't going to happen with Bill Nelson. He will unify his party, and he will get as much of that 500,000 voter advantage as he can. If he only gets 20% of it, and the rest stay home, is 100,000 votes. Rick Scott won by 60,000. There's a comparator. If I hadn't voted for him, he'd only won for 59,999. He's going to unify his party. He's going to go after the veteran vote. He tells them every day what he's done for them. And he did suit up, and he didn't wear a uniform. 1.5 and 1.7 million military veterans in this state. It's one of the biggest voting blocks. If we got veterans in here, you guys call me out if I'm wrong. But on a level playing field, they will respect a veteran over someone they never put a uniform on. If I'm Bill Nelson, I'm going to go after the veterans. And then when I get a Senate candidate in a debate, I'm going to walk him right where U.S. senators go. And I'm going to say, son, here's what U.S. senators do. What is your real experience, not your speech experience, in national security and national defense, in the global economy, in foreign affairs, and foreign policy, and embassy operations? We better put someone who can go toe-to-toe with him and say, okay, Bill, I like that. Let's get your resume out in mind. Let's look at your military, your national security, education, training, and real-world experience, your global economy experience and training and education, embassy operations, and let's get on with this. I would have a fun day. But we better put someone in there that can do it with credibility, because he's going to call them out. And giving speeches ain't going to cover it. He's going to say, let's look at your resume. Let me ask you this. How many of you here have children or grandchildren? My friends, this next election for U.S. Senate is about your children, your grandchildren, and mine in our country. It's very serious business. I'm going to ask you. To ask yourself this, who do you want in the U.S. Senate facing down these global threats? Vladimir Putin's of the former Soviet Union, the Irans, the Chinas, the Koreas. One other thing, I'm not a lawyer. You get two other choices at that. And I'm going to ask you to make a serious hiring decision. Match the job to the resumes. All right, a lot of people think that our national security and our freedom is a given, but it's not. You remember Ronald Reagan as well as I do. He had a saying, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. My friends, this is still the land of the free and the home of the brave and one nation under God. We must keep this country strong, safe, and prosperous, and stop those who want to give it away or take it away. And failure is simply not an option. I've enjoyed my time here. My job next year is to retire Bill Nelson and send Barack Obama packing at the same time. Certainly like your support. I've got a few bumper stickers, and I'll take your name and your contact information. I want to thank you again, my friends. We have a serious job next year. May God bless you. May God bless America.
I was very concerned about our largest domestic terrorism with Major Hassan. Can you tell me what that says about the culture in our armed forces, in political correctness, and what should be done about it? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm no longer there, which means I don't get any intel reports. I think we need to recognize a couple of things, and I am going to answer your question, because it's a big question. Because we need to recognize the media has no security clearance. I doubt that anyone in here does anymore unless you still are working in national security. So we never really know the realities or the truths by design, because guess who watches our TV, listens to our radio, and reads our newspaper? The bad guys. Now, what the government will do sometimes is they'll let things leak, and we call it misinformation and disinformation, because they want the enemy to think something different than what is the reality. I don't know what the background was of that behind the scenes, but I think we need to take a look at this. We need to recognize, you know, sometimes if something looks like a duck and it sounds like a duck, it's a duck. And I think that in any scenario, we always have to give people the benefit of any doubt until they prove themselves otherwise. But I think we always have to take a close look at what's going on. I think we have to apply all of our lessons learned. And I think in some of these cases where we've had people inside our military that have turned out to be not on our side, it's very concerning. And I'm going to tell you what that reminds me of. It was when the guy walked out of Los Alamos National Laboratory with a set of blueprints. And you look what his name was. So I think that there's no place in this for political correctness. And for our country, we're going to have to get rid of all this political correctness and coddling. And the liberals are going to have to just recognize if we go down, they're going down too, including the media, who most of them are for profit. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I have a question for you because I've looked at your book.
Okay.
Right Future is your book, and it came out last year in 2010.
Well, it was wrote 2 years ago, but it was published last year.
Okay. And we've gone through some of the passages in your book and found some inconsistencies, which I would like to ask you about at this point.
Go ahead.
For example, I have several. I'm not going to do them all.
Right, but I'm going to say one thing to you. Did you read the endorsements of the book as well?
Not really.
Well, maybe you should.
I know one person who endorsed it.
All right, let me just throw out so for the rest of the audience. To avoid people thinking that I'm writing this, and some people will say, oh, I know what, I got an engineer I'm going to have a conversation with. I'm going to ask her to define for me torque, stress, and tension. And then I'm going to take an encyclopedia and a dictionary and say, no, that's what this means. So what I did was I went to highly credentialed subject matter experts that understand the terminology in that book as it's applied in that area of study. So I would just recommend you read those endorsements. For example, the education chapter has three academic university deans that endorse that book. On the jobs, every one of them. So I'm just throwing it out there. I went to a lot of trouble to have credentialed experts read that book so that when people look at it, they can see this is a peer-reviewed document. So go ahead, throw your question.
My question is, on page 9,
I don't have the tables memorized, but
you are opposed to offshore drilling in Florida.
Yeah.
Both inside and outside the 200-mile exclusive economic zone, because the environment cannot afford the price of failure.
Okay.
And now we hear that you are totally for drilling. My concern is that...
Okay, well, let me answer the question, okay? Let me answer the question.
Let her ask it.
All right, go ahead. I think your concern is that I changed my stance.
Well, that, and my concern is that you've been visiting a lot of Tea Party groups.
Always did, even last year when I wrote the book, and signed the book and gave it to them. There's nothing new about that.
Right, which I really appreciate, because I think those are the new educated Americans, but go ahead.
All right, here's where I stand on it. And I also wrote in the book, and I don't know if you quoted that line, that says, I reserve the right to change my view as circumstances change. Did you find that in there?
Well, I think that's, yeah, goes
I think that goes without reason.